Good afternoon, everybody. Thanks for coming out. Now it's a nice day to listen to us wax on poetically for half an hour. It's a real treat to have our friend here today. Wow. How long have you been in Victoria?
13 years now.
13 yeah. years. So for you that don't know, this is the former CEO of Abe Books, which was an Amazon company here in Victoria. So he's been around the sector a while. He's been the head of a large company in Victoria and has a lot of experience with the community as well as with this sector. So this is a real treat to have him here today with us. So thanks for you guys for coming out, and thank you for taking the time to do this. I know you're busy.
So I pleasure, appreciate pleasure. That.
So let's talk about busy. What is a typical day look like for you? Give us your week schedule.
As a VC now, you mean?
Well, you can throw in some tennis games.
Yeah, sure. That always has to be in there, actually. There's an abundance of information nowadays, so you could read all morning. I actually use a neat tool called Feedly, where I can go through all the headlines of the blogs that I subscribed and usually get a pretty quick, good overview of what's happening. After that, I often have set up some calls with my colleagues from Europe. So Acton Capital, maybe I give you a little bit of background. I'm the North American venture partner of a $200 million fund that's based in Munich. My whole team is based in Munich. I'm the only guy in North America. And have a long history with these guys. They it was a corporate VC before for a large German media company, and they backed up Abe Books very early on when we bought out the founders, and they were crazy enough to put me in the CEO seat. So, and we're still talking. That's a good thing. Anyway, they wanted me to become part of the VC company, and I said, sure, but I'm going to stay in Victoria. Victoria is my place where I want to live. And they said, fantastic, let's do it. North American venture partner, I'm looking for opportunities here to add to our core focus in Europe. So the whole team sits in Munich, and then we usually have some calls to catch up, talk about opportunities. Or I often talk to some of the entrepreneurs that we have on the East Coast. I have a few boards that I'm on the East Coast now as well to catch up with these guys. In addition to that, what's part of a typical day is, of course, looking at new pitches that come in, at new opportunities. And maybe set up the 3-4 calls a week, I would say, that kind of make it through the first filter, where you do an intro call for an hour with a founder to see if you want to take it to the next stage. And then there's always a couple of things that are a little harder, where you're in due diligence or you're actually negotiating a deal and you still have to look through all the legal stuff and where there's a little bit more deep dive work necessary. So that's the normal day. But as you said, I try to throw in the tennis match occasionally.
I'm teasing him. For you that don't know, this is a national ranked tennis player we're also sitting with. So interesting the way you're describing that. One of the words that keeps coming up, certainly in academia, is curator. And I think Rob probably, you know, we could call him a curator at this point. So we're seeing that now at all levels, that there's so much information out there that you need a piece of technology to actually help you get through it. So I think for you in the audience, one of the things to remember with the mentor community and the investment community is we're all doing that all day long. We're trying to stay ahead of things and we're trying to figure out what the trends are. So when you're talking to somebody, you know, make sure that those are part of the questions you're asking, because I think there's a lot of value in, you know, and I think I asked you a question one day and, you know, you knew all about that space and you had a really good, you know, opinion and idea about something we were talking about, and you just saved me a week's worth of work. So I appreciate that, but I also recognize it's important to have those conversations.
Yeah, I'm sometimes actually, I used to help with as an EIR here at Viatech for a while too, and it's sometimes surprising. I mean, there's companies who kind of have that idea and they come up with think they really have a great idea, but you know, then you say to them, well, have you looked at XYZ in New York? They've been doing that for 2 years. They've kind of raised $15 million, et cetera, right? I say, oh. So I'm sometimes a little surprised when startups don't do their homework and kind of do really dig into the details and try to find out what's out there, what's the competition, is the model proven yet, etc. So that's not a good start.
The market is bigger than Victoria. And again, that's the other thing about Canada that's really exciting. And, you know, I'm looking at Sophie here in the audience. She's from Shanghai and does risk management. Hannes is from the Black Forest in Europe. I'm sure there's somebody here from the Latin American, you know, community that we've got somebody from that has a connection to Korea. Like, I just look out into the audience and, you know, when you're doing due diligence on your growth strategy or your startup, those are some of the questions you should be asking because, you know, it's quite interesting to, you know, to discover what is going on in other places of the world and how far ahead they are in different spaces. So with that said, the other thing that caught my attention, so you're from the Black Forest originally?
That's true. I think you can say that. Yeah.
So I'm thinking about you hanging around that roadside bar with the bikers and, you know, talking about, you know, who you are and why you're in Canada and what you're doing here. And what would you tell somebody in a restaurant or somebody, a friend of a friend that says, what do you do? And, you know, and they, you use the word, say, startup community. And they're like, oh, I know what that means. How would you describe Victoria to somebody in Europe as a startup community?
As a startup community? Yeah, so I think Victoria is a startup community with a lot of potential from my perspective. And we're seeing more and more things blossoming. But I think it's still very small, let's face it. It has a slight bias towards gaming and marketing arbitrage business in the past years, but this is changing. I think what we're lacking is kind of more long-term thinking coupled with a strong belief that you can actually create a large company here, right? Kind of that really long-term perspective that a lot of the other customers, a lot of the other companies actually have in some of the larger cities. At the same time, Victoria is such an incredible place to live. That's why a lot of us are here, right? I think there's a lot of distraction, and that sometimes makes it a little harder to build a startup here, right? If some of your friends say, hey, come on, let's go biking at 4 o'clock, or let's play tennis, just, you know, as another example. It's not that easy to kind of go all in here, I think, for everybody. And I've seen that when I came here. So when I came here from Germany, we worked our asses off, right? In the first kind of phase, I co-founded a business, 99, in Germany, and we went through the first dot-com bust. And the only reason we survived is because we were extremely frugal. We were improving the numbers continuously. And we worked really, really hard and tried to leverage everything. Now, that's the only way you can really do it. It's still, I think that's still the same, even though there's many, many opportunities. So Victoria has a lot of potential. I think a lot of talent here. But I really want to see more of those long-term thinking, kind of sustainable businesses that can really be built here.
So I think, actually, it was interesting when you presented, that was my thought in my head while you were presenting at the end. I thought, now, how could we build that and keep it in Victoria? You know, how do we keep that as a tentpole company here? So I think everybody's starting to think that the same way. And then the other thing that kind of goes on in my head a lot is, how do we balance that lifestyle with the exportable technology company? Like, how do we get them to that third or fourth rung in the ladder so that people can have both the income, the lifestyle, and the stability in those corporations? And I think the short answer that we all know is work your ass off for a couple of years and build a company that's sustainable. But I think we're all on the same page on that for sure as a community.
Yeah. I think you know what we need is actually we need more anchor tech companies. Like it used to be like the Schneider Electric and us at 8 Books, right? But now we're seeing more like the Meta Lab, MediaCore, and what Todd's building again is great. But also Carmana now, run by Rob Simmons, it's a totally different company that kind of has a longer term vision. And but at 8 Books, we often had the problem that if we wanted to hire high caliber talent to Victoria and they knew the Amazon culture, which is tough, they were worried that there's no plan B here in Victoria, right? So if they move their family out and have a great opportunity here, what happens if it doesn't work out? And that's exactly what's missing. We need like 10, 15 anchor companies that make it over 100, over 150, 250 employees, and that's what we need to build. So then you also have a lot of offshoots. But at the same time, it is possible to actually do that. Even before we became Amazon, we hired people from Sony New York from Amazon brought them into our company, and that made a huge difference also in a way to kind of exemplify a different attitude towards work, right? It was like more kind of getting that stuff done, whatever it takes, and not making sure that you pick up your child at 3:45 at the school. And I'm exaggerating a little bit. This is super important. I'm a dad myself, and I love that. But you know, when you want to build a startup, right? You just have to get shit done. That's it. And bringing people in who are ruthless in that and who have experienced that in other cultures and can exemplify that behavior as leaders within companies, I think that's what you need early on when you think about bringing in your next level of management. That's something that we've had great experience at 8Books.
Yeah, I would agree with that. A couple of things I've noticed is, you know, around the kind of founder CEO point before you're acquired is there is an opportunity, if you're really bold, and an HR opportunity to actually say to your employees, if you're really noodling a good idea, you know, go off and do it, and we'll, you know, we won't hold your job, but we'll certainly fast track your resume if it doesn't work. So that's actually a, you know, an HR opportunity there. The other one is just around competitiveness, and I've been thinking about this a lot lately, that as Canadians and certainly Islanders, we don't actually realize how competitive the world really is once we get outside this country and this city. And for any of you from other countries, and certainly anybody that's worked internationally, and for me, part of my background's working in the American automotive business in Michigan. And man, coming from here where, you know, everything was laid back and good times, and going there, my knees were shaking when I first got there, realizing, you know, how aggressive they were, how hard they worked. And after a while, I realized it was that competitive. So here, you know, you can breeze through high school, breeze through university, get a job, you know, we just don't have that competitive thing. So I think, to your point, as a European, that's probably what you're picking up on with that lifestyle. And again, is that lifestyle worth preserving? Do we need to find that balance? And, you know, there's an argument for both sides. And then at what point in the business?
Yeah, and I think, you know, that lifestyle is definitely fabulous here, right? But as I said, it's kind of that differentiation of when it's really required to go hard, right? To really work hard. And I think that's sometimes lacking. There's kind of too much focus on the lifestyle in many cases. But that's changing. I think we see a lot of companies that are now really willing to go all the way here, and I'm encouraged by what we're seeing these days. Really encouraged.
The other thing, as I say, I was at the University of Victoria Science Fair this weekend. Anybody looking for talent? Wow. I've never met more focused, dedicated young people in my life than at that science fair. That was a real eye-opener. So, you know, get out there and find them.
The other thing I should add, right? I mean, if we think of Victoria as a location, I think Canada itself provides so many benefits for startups where you can really compete extremely well. I mean, Tony's here. There's so many government-funded programs. You all know them. You've all heard of SHRED, but there's many more, IRAP, etc., where you can get funds. The EBC thing is fantastic for investors. I've invested in a lot of companies and always love the EBC credit certificate at the end of the year, where you get 30% back, right, as a tax credit. So there's an end, and we should never forget that you all have, when you're entrepreneurs here, you have a real advantage in terms of salaries over the US. Massive, right? Yes, it's still hard to find developers here, but hey, you can find them. Build great bridges to the University of Victoria. They have great talent there. More junior, you probably have to hire more senior talent somewhere else, but there's great talent there, and the salary advantage is massive, right? You don't want to know what they pay now in the Valley. Some of you do. It's shocking for really good developers.
So let's talk about valuations and just kind of the difference between Angel VC, Victoria, outside of Victoria in Canada, the US, and also in Europe. Are you seeing big differences? And I'll give you an example. So I hear a lot kind of in the BC market that pre-revenue, $2 million valuation, you know, 10% of the company. Like there is kind of a benchmark showing up now. How would you compare that to other places, both from the angel perspective and then later stage?
I think, you know, I mean, there's entrepreneurs here in Victoria, and as I said, I've done quite a few angel investments too. I think a lot of the entrepreneurs take a relatively realistic and reasonable approach here in Victoria. So we've done rounds where companies just wanted to get a good group of angels involved, like Checkfront is a good example, at a very reasonable valuation, but I think it was helpful for them too, to get kind of a larger local group that helps them down the road. So that's reasonable. I think some of the valuations that have evolved that you hear about in the US and the expectations of some entrepreneurs are just unrealistic and not sustainable. So we're already seeing those coming down, and I think everybody who follows the news there already knows that, right? I mean, valuations are coming down, there's more pressure on them, especially SaaS, kind of all those multiples, you can track it on different sources. So there's a good time now to bring some sanity into the market, and I think to be able to do a good funding round nowadays, you have to check all the boxes, right? You have to have a great team, you have to have great traction, you have to know your numbers, etc. There's nothing that can be really open there.
I think just to echo your point about, he was talking about Checkfront, which is a group of tech entrepreneurs that really got together casually to make this investment. I won't call it syndicated, but it was certainly a group investment. And I think what's interesting about that is, as entrepreneurs, you know, I know you're broke, you're hungry, you're desperate, you're moving along at the speed of light. But I can't echo that enough to really think about who those early stage investors are and what do they bring to the table, because money really isn't what you need. What you need is acceleration to revenue, and you know, sometimes that can come with a contact faster than it can with a check, from my experience. So I want to echo that point.
Yeah, but I fully agree. But you know, I mean, just to give you an idea, Checkfront did raise with a semi-syndicate or so, a bunch of us guys, and we raised $1 million here locally in Victoria, which is not insignificant, right? So it's possible here, but you have to have good traction.
Yeah, and that actually brings up another good point for the entrepreneurs. There's a lot of money in this province, and if you're not getting funded, it's probably what you're doing. And I've seen, you know, people raise $5 million in 2 phone calls. So don't think there's not money. It's just, you know, it's where that money's flowing and why. And I like to tell people, it's hot lava. It has to go somewhere. So, you know, you got to get out of its way and let it flow and you know, have a business that's actually fundable. And, you know, I think Honest would agree with that. Right now, a lot of that is B2B, you know, SaaS plays with revenue that's looking to accelerate growth. So there's actually a sweet spot, and it's cyclical. That changes year to year or every couple of years. So, you know, that's the kind of stuff where a place like Viatech could really, you know, add value by educating people on, you know, what the market's looking for, both from a customer and investor perspective, and, you know, design your companies around, you know, around that connection if you want that high growth. So let's move on to another question. This is a interesting one. So should startups change their pitch for investors outside of Victoria? So if you were going to pitch a group of investors in British Columbia versus New York versus, you know, Hamburg versus somewhere else, would they?
Forest.
The Black Forest. Yeah, that's it. Yeah, you know, what would you suggest? Would they need to change at all?
What do you guys think?
I'm. And did you write that question?
Yes, somebody said yes.
Lana, did you write that question?
My name is Sophie Liu. I work at ST Venture Consulting. I'm very curious because I was BC, Victoria, 80 years. Viatech is very well known in BC. However, there are lots of investors in overseas. They're very interested in buying some IT business in BC, but they don't. I don't think we do lots of advertisement. Or just my question is, your Andrew, whatever, a capital funding company, how to attract investors to help our local business owner to grow their business internationally instead of it's BC, not only manufacturing China, or to share, like you said, you found the clients who are interested in raising money, they provide the business report. They found that this already technology already exists 3-4 years. It's a waste of time. For me, I do lots of compacting marketing research. That's very important. The IT industry every day was changing. So that's
maybe let's go back to the original question quickly.
Yeah.
I don't think you should change the pitch, personally. I think you should have a pitch that is just great to kind of really tell the story about your business. And I wouldn't bend over and kind of change my pitch based on what every potential investor tells you. One tells you, hey, make sure how you can, you know, create the multiple for selling the company, etc. You know what? Unless there's kind of the pitch is incomplete or not good or whatever, right? Yeah, take advice. But if you're convinced that you have a great pitch, you sell that story really well, you should stick to that and maybe fine-tune it over time and see what works. But changing the pitch of whether you're in Victoria or Seattle or Vancouver, no, you know, the good companies, they can pitch anywhere, right? Because they get that story across really well, right? And I think the only thing I would say is like the earlier you are, right, the more it's about kind of the story and the vision, etc., right? And the further along you are, the more you have to kind of back it up with data, right? I used to say at 8 Books, I always quoted them when somebody came in with some. I said, listen, in God we trust, all others bring data, right? So if somebody said, hey, I believe, is that, you know what? That looks like a problem you can prove with data. So go ahead, do it, right? And I think that's what you have to think about as well in terms of startups. You know, if you try to get a group of angel investors together, hey, this is a cool story. You know, what can I prove with data? I'll do, right? But there's probably a lot of missing pieces where you still sell the vision. But the further along you are, you better got your numbers right? And you better have all those questions that are coming up, you're able to answer them with hard data, right? If somebody asks you about LTV in a SaaS business, and you can't show cohort analysis, and you can't show LTV over a certain period of time, you're just not running your business well, and you're not gonna get funding. Neither here, nor in Seattle, nor in Hamburg.
Yeah, and again, I echo that 100%. And I think for you that have pitched today and for you that are pitching at another point in your career, that it's actually the Q&As that's most interesting from our perspective is, you know, how do you answer the question? What is the answer to the question? Who's asking the question? Is the person asking the question somebody I respect? Do I care about the question? So what you don't see under that, you know, the iceberg under the water, the amount of stuff that's going on in our head, when there's a group of people in a room with one person asking a question, it's unbelievable. And I should actually start writing it down just to show you the infograph of the 3,000 questions when Thomas says something that I ask myself, you know, because Thomas loves asking that same question every time. And it's a good start, right? And so I think, I think for you guys, recognize that Q&A is actually more important than your presentation in a lot of ways.
I couldn't agree more. When you develop your pitch, right, I think what I often say to people, and that is true for even for product managers within companies, right? You're a product manager, you really own a product, you want to sell it internally, right? You better already and anticipate 80% of the questions that will be asked in that first meeting with the executive team or so, right? If you can't do that, you're not a good product manager, full stop. You have a real problem. Especially now, I mean, the culture that I was in at Amazon, that was just a no-go. And the same is true for investment pitches, right? If you can't answer most of the questions that are coming up, ideally with some backup data, that's just not a good impression. Or the I follow up later thing, right?
Yeah, and there's a book that came out last year called Value Proposition Design, the same people that wrote the Business Model Canvas. If you haven't read it, read it. And it's actually a really, for senior executives, it's great if you always have an employee that comes to you with a new idea every day that really should be an entrepreneur but likes the security of work. It's a great book to say, you know, every time you have a new idea, I want you to run it through value proposition design before you bring it back to me. And for any entrepreneurs, before you invest money in developing a product, it's actually a really good methodology to follow. And I just can't stress enough about that book, Value Proposition Design. So moving on. Oh, this is here's the million-dollar question. Actually, before we ask that, how many people in the room are actually currently raising money at the early stage, just past friends and family? Show of hands. All right, so for those people that were brave enough to put up your hand, do any of you have a question you'd like to ask our group today? So you're asking, should you start here looking for investment, or should you start somewhere else looking for investment? or a combination of both? Wow. I'm going to let you answer first. I have an answer, but I'm going to let you.
Yeah, I think you know, first of all, I think as I said before, there's a really good group of investors here, and I think it depends very much whether you think it's a good fit for your business, right? What do you need? Do you need specific expertise in a field? Then you have kind of your list of A investors that you should identify even early on that you want on board. And then I always call it stretching, kind of try to get the pitch out with a few kind of C or B list investors before you actually go and approach the A list investors to really hone your pitch. I think you can't say it's kind of based on locale. I think it's very dependent on what you think you need for the business. What are kind of the perfect investors that you have? Could be based on industry knowledge, network, or kind of where you think that they can really help you in terms of the stage where you are.
So for you, Nicholas, I would say Victoria is really good for what you're doing, and I know your business. So I'll give you an example to kind of echo what he's saying, is that I was speaking in Kelowna on Friday, and there's a young man up there that's in a very busy space, which is the fintech space, and he'd had some difficulties with pay-to-pitch, which is where you pay an organization to go on a kind of roadshow pitching, and he's fairly upset and asking questions publicly but directed at me and looking for my help. And what I realized was why is a guy in fintech in Kelowna? And so I think when you're working in a sector, especially something like fintech, which has really got a lot of law and security wrapped around it, I mean, it's a sophisticated play, you probably need to be in New York. So my question to him was, have you looked at accelerator programs that are fintech specific, either, you know, in the major banking cities? And he wasn't willing to leave Kelowna because of lifestyle. And so as an investor, put yourself in those shoes. When you hear that, what does that tell you, right? So it's an interesting kind of process for you as the entrepreneur, but also for the investor. What are you willing to do to make this work? Is my money going to, you know, going to be pushed further and faster? And from the entrepreneur, what am I willing to actually sacrifice to do it? Because you can run a fintech company anywhere in the world if it was up and running, but to get it up and running, how do you do that? So in his case, he probably should go into an accelerator, Y Combinator, there's one in New York, and then come back. And the example in Victoria, which I just cannot say enough about, is Send With Us. Sorry, I've been working with Send With News lately, so I'm mixing them up. Send With, there went to Y Combinator, the sales and marketing teams in San Francisco, the dev teams here. It's worked out incredibly well. They accelerated their contacts, their network, and they're doing great things in the city of Victoria. So anybody here, apply to Y Combinator and ask them about their business model, because I think it's really successful for the startup ecosystem in Victoria to echo what they're doing at.
Totally agree with Send With Us. Totally selfless, of course. I am an investor. But yeah, they've done a great job in applying for Y Combinator, and it's been extremely helpful for them, right? And they kept their sales part in San Francisco and have the dev team here. It's great.
The other thing I was going to say, and shameless self-plug, ask people like Rob, myself, Hannes, Todd. There's lots of people in the community. Ask them who the investors that they know you should be pitching to. Because I think I see, you know, I probably get inquiries about three times a day from people looking for money. And I've started to realize that I also have this other group of people that now is quite large outside of Victoria that have said, I'm actively looking for X. You know, so I have a woman currently looking to invest $5 million in green technology that's a hardware software play. If you can bring that to me, I can get you money. So we all have those networks, and we're happy to vet them and share them, because we care about the community as much as anybody and want to thrive here. So don't ask people for money. Ask them who you should be pitching for. That's really the first question, I think. Okay, so you're doing angel investing locally, but you're also working as a venture capitalist. So I'm going to ask this question to you as an angel investor. How and when should a founder approach you for investment? Is it ever too early to pitch?
As an angel investor? Man, I'm trying to dial that down a little bit, the angel investment piece. But no, for an angel investor, it's actually never too early, from my perspective. I think, you know, if you're an entrepreneur and you're trying to kind of reach out to those people and try to get advice early on and you know, get feedback for the idea and trying to fine tune your idea, I think that's really helpful. Use the local network, right? I mean, any of us that have done angel investing are always happy to help entrepreneurs because we've been there as well, right? We've been early on, but we had no clue about how we're going to do it. And, you know, it was hard. And we're always happy to grab a coffee with you guys and love to do that, right? I love to see that entrepreneurial spirit. So I think doing that is the foundation. And then, you know, once you kind of get really good, you kind of raise that interest. And then hopefully, you know, there's some other introductions. But from a VC perspective, I think that's a slightly different story, right? I mean,
what are the metrics for somebody approaching you
for Acton Capital? Yeah. So as I said, we just raised our second fund. It's a $200 million US fund, and we're really focused on the growth stage. So let me give you a couple of examples of what I just recently did. So I was involved in a $15 million round that we led in Eloquy, which is a fashion company based in New York, and they are focused on conquering the US market, plus size market, 14 and up. It's a really underserved market. They're already, like, you know, way past $10 million last year, so a little larger. And then another example that I led and I joined the board recently is Mobify in Vancouver. Some of you guys might know that. A great team, three founders. They've bootstrapped the business to over 100 employees profitably and really want to kind of, you know, take off now. So we led a $10 million round in Mobify that closed in January, and really trying to help them continue to grow, you know. But they already have a great list of customers and as I said, a significant team that already has an incredible job kind of getting to where they are right now. So yeah, in terms of growth investment, our usual ticket is around 5 to 8 million US. And underneath that, we do the occasional exception where we see a company or a space that we're really excited about and we just want to get a foot in the door with a 1 million investment or so, where we think the likelihood of doing a follow-up round is very high. But that's really the exception. 2 minutes.
So we can socially engineer this process. If you look at this, reverse engineer it. So what space is he looking for? What do I need to do before I get there? How do I get them interested and into a conversation? And, you know, I love that that saying, and I'm sure you all know it, but if you want money, ask for advice, and if you want advice, ask for money. And I think that's really true. And you know, to have somebody in our community that has your experience and your background and the fact that you have done angel investing and you've worked for a big company and now you're doing venture capital, I mean, this is the mountain you need to talk to, because there's very few people with that background.
Let me be clear about that. I'd love to have a company in Victoria. Reduces my travel, right? I don't enjoy traveling. I was just in New York last week for 2 days. Sucks. The traveling sucks, but anyway, it's still cool. But so you know, first time we have, you know, we have a couple. We have Clio and Indochino from the first fund in Vancouver, and now we have Mobify. But I'd love to have something in Victoria. We have a few things on the East Coast. We were in Etsy too with the first fund. But eventually, hopefully, we'll have something here on the island. That would be really cool.
You can have a 12-minute commute.
That's right.
So this is actually a good question. So I'm going to go over time because I can. What is a mistake entrepreneurs make when looking for investments that you see over and over again? So what is something that people keep doing where you think, my God, I keep seeing that pattern. I wish they'd stop doing it. And I'm going to call out education here because I think that's probably where that comes from. So what's something that you see that just
I think stop? we covered that piece. It's not valuation. I think it's the unanticipated questions that can't be answered really well, right? I mean, if you pitch and here's a question about the market size or a competitor that wasn't on your radar screen, or somebody knows something out of that market, right, that comes as a total surprise to you, it's just a red flag. Full stop. I think that's the biggest thing that we often see also with more advanced entrepreneurs, that is just disqualifies you very quickly. It's just a no-go.
What's the book, No More Than Your VC, or anybody know what I'm talking about? There's a book that's No More About Deals Than Your VC or something. Actually, it's a good read for people that just have no idea where to start. Okay, so what advice do you have for entrepreneurs here today? What's the takeaway besides call you and buy you a very expensive lunch, not just coffee?
Yeah, I think, as I said before, it's in line with that. I think the think big piece is very important, right? And honestly, that is something I always thought with 8Books, we were very international. We had like millions of customers. We had a relatively sizable business. Once you become part of Amazon, you feel like nothing, right? It's like there you really learn how to think big, right? If you don't have a $1 billion idea, you're not even getting 5 developers actually to it, right? So it's like that think big, think long term, and being stubborn on vision, but flexible on the details, etc. So things like that are really, really important. And the Amazon leadership principles are extremely good for that. I'm a big fan of them. We've adopted them at 8Books. It's not easy as a subsidiary when you kind of join a large company, but we've discussed it a lot and we really bought into it. So think big and the strong belief that you can build something that is really sustainable here on the island, and you have to, think global. The world is flat. You can build it from here, right? I mean, at 8Books, Canada was 4% of our business, just to be clear. And I know a lot of companies where this is the case, right? So you can really build a world-class business from here if you do it right.
Right. I think another way of saying that is life's very short. Don't waste your time on small ideas and small things. And I see that all the time where I think, man, these people just are working on the wrong thing and the clock's ticking, So yeah, enjoy it and think big. Great. Well, thanks for doing this.
Thanks a lot.
Every time.